Good day. Recently, I've got a lot of questions asking about the Jumper R1F F-Port telemetry receiver, specifically how to connect it to your flight controller to get telemetry working. I've got a similar video to this on the Jumper R1 receiver, which uses S-Bus and S-Port. You can check out through a link in the video description below, along with links to the R1F receiver and the rookie pilot-friendly Fast Track FPV course, Your Clear Flight Path to FPV Fun. So today, I'll take a look at the Jumper R1F receiver and show you how I've hooked it up to my flight stack. I've also created for you this easy-to-follow, step-by-step graphical setup checklist, which you can download through a link in the video description below. I'll also show you how to set it up in Betaflight and bind it with your transmitter to get that telemetry going. Of course, I'll be using my Jumper T16. However, this process should work the same with your Jumper T12 Pro, Jumper T18, RadioMaster TX16S, or any other transmitter running OpenTX firmware and with a multi-protocol module. Once again, all of this is in the checklist I mentioned earlier, which you can download below. Sound good? Make sure to give this video a thumbs up below, share it with your pilot buddies, and if you haven't subscribed yet, what are you waiting for? Hit that subscribe button and that little bell next to it to make sure you get notified of all new posts on your TMac FPV channel, your home for your journey to better FPV fun, flights, and racing stuff. And here's our Jumper R1F F-Port telemetry receiver. 20.75 by 15.7 by 3. And it weighs in at 2 grams. And here it is next to the FreeSky RXSR receiver, which is also a telemetry receiver. And you can upload F-Port firmware to it. Here is the Jumper regular R1 receiver, which comes with S-Bus and S-Port. Here is the Jumper R1F. The two obviously look very similar. The R1F has a smaller form factor simply because they've taken the connector off of it and included solder pads. Prior to getting into our connection and setup of our Jumper R1F, I want to make sure we're all clear on something. Before you purchase and plan on using any F-Port receiver like the Jumper R1F, it's important to understand the requirements F-Port has for a flight controller. Not all flight controllers will be compatible with F-Port telemetry. The implementation of these requirements are different for F7 or F3 flight controllers than they are for F4 flight controllers. First, we'll take a look at F7 and F3 flight controllers. With these, you can connect the F-Port wire from your Jumper R1F receiver to the S-Port pad of your flight controller or any spare UARTX pad. So if you're using an F7 or an F3 flight controller with enough UARTs, you shouldn't have any issues finding a place to connect your F-Port wire to obtain telemetry. After you've connected your F-Port receiver to your F7 or F3 flight controller, you'll want to input these commands into the CLI within Betaflight, and I'll go over that later. For F4 flight controllers, it's a little different. You, of course, can connect the F-Port wire from your Jumper R1F receiver to the S-Port pad of your F4 flight controller just as you did with your F7 flight controller, and all will be good. Of course, this means your flight controller needs to have an S-Port pad, which is something you'll want to verify in its specs and documentation. In a 20x20 flight controller, all-in-one flight controller, or a 16x16 flight controller, you may have a hard time finding one. And with an F4, if you don't have an S-Port pad, you're not able to use just any TX pad like you were able to do with the F7 or F3. That's because on an F4 flight controller, not all TX pads have inversion designed into them. You'll need to find one that does, if any exist, on your particular flight controller. So you need a special TX pad, which does have a hardware inverter, and these are usually labeled for telemetry on the board itself or in the flight controller documentation. So you'll want to see your flight controller's specs and manual to locate these pads, hopefully prior to purchasing an F-Port receiver. Once you've connected your F-Port receiver to your F4 flight controller using the S-Port pad or a TX pad with inversion, you'll want to input these commands into the CLI within Betaflight. Now, I've been talking about the Jumper R1F receiver here. There are other receivers which use F-Port that have uninverted pads or a very small pin of a component you can solder to and use for connection to any TX pad on your F4 flight controller. One such receiver is the FreeSky RXSR shown here. If you use an uninverted pad on your receiver, you want to input these commands into the CLI within Betaflight. One more thing to consider when talking about requirements. You may be tempted to try using soft serial for one of your TX pads that doesn't have an inverter. This is not recommended because in addition to telemetry with F-Port, you're also transmitting your control signal over the same wire for your quadcopter.
and soft serial is not equipped for that type of data rate. It could cause bad things to happen. So, in summary, using F-port with F4 flight controllers can get messy. It either requires a special type of TX pad with inversion, or your receiver needs to have an uninverted S-port pad or a component pin to connect to. And as I've mentioned, I'm hard-pressed to find a flight controller of 20 by 20 size or smaller with a dedicated S-port pad or TX pad with inversion. If you know of one, please put it down in the comments below. So why use F-port at all? What's the advantage to it? Well, it does save one RX pad of one UART, which can be used for other purposes by using 3 wires instead of 4. Let me know in the comments below what you would do with one extra RX pad of one UART. And it does have a slightly faster data rate, but because it has combined your control signal with your telemetry signal, it does come with limitations as to what type of flight controller you can use. In my opinion, if you want to use F-port telemetry and don't want to mess around with finding a very specific F4 flight controller, it's best to get a receiver capable of running F-port firmware that also has an uninverted connection for S-port, like the RXSR. Or just go with an F7 flight controller, which is what I'm going to do right now. The flight controller I'll be using is the Mamba Mini F722. For a look at this specific flight controller and a few other 20x20 F7 flight controllers, check out this video on micro-FPV flight controllers. Now, let's see how I've connected my Jumper R1F to my Mamba Mini F722. I've decided to connect my Jumper R1F F-port telemetry receiver to the TX4 pad of my flight controller. Once I've got it connected, I can then bind it to the internal multi-protocol module of my T16, go into Betaflight and toggle on the appropriate settings in both the Ports tab and Configuration tab, and input any necessary changes to the Serial RX Half Duplex and Serial RX Inverted commands into the CLI. Let's go ahead and do that now, then we'll look at getting our telemetry in our jumper.
All right, we're going to go ahead and bind our Jumper R1F to our internal multi-protocol module of our Jumper T16. And in order to do so, I'm looking at the instructions for the Jumper R1F, and here's what they say. Press and hold the receiver's bind button, turn on the power, the receiver will now enter binding mode. The green light is always on, and the red light is flashing slowly. So initially, we want a steady green light and a red light flashing slowly. Then we're going to turn on the transmitter and enter the bind procedure, and after the bind is successful, the green light will be off, and the red light is always on. Now that's exactly opposite of what I'm used to with regards to free sky receivers, where the green light is always on. All right, let's go ahead and follow those procedures and see what happens. First, we notice that our external RF mode is off. We're going to scroll up and under internal RF for this version of the multi-protocol module firmware and the Jumper R1F, I've selected free sky D16, channels 1 through 16, and I've also got a receiver number in here that's applicable for this model. This number is not shared with any other receiver. I'm going to get it ready by going down to bind, and we want to bind this channels 9 through 16 with telemetry on. I'm going to leave it right there, and then I'm going to depress and hold the bind button over here on our Jumper R1F and power it on as the instructions state. All right, we're going to press and hold the bind button, power it on, and press this. Release, exit out, power cycle receiver.
RF, signal, critical.
And now we've got the red light constantly on, like the instructions said. That tells me that the receiver is bound.
All right, now we're going to set this thing up in Betaflight. We go to our ports tab. Since we're using UART 4, TX pad 4, that's UART 4. That's what we're going to toggle on for serial RX. Click save and reboot. Go back there to make sure it's saved. Now we go to configuration and we select serial based receiver and go down here to FR Sky F port. And then we also want to make sure that telemetry is toggled on and click save and reboot. Next, we want to go to our CLI and check out our half duplex and inverted commands, see what they're set up for. To do that, we type get serial, and our serial RX inverted is on, and our serial RX half duplex is on. And that's actually what we want based on the CLI commands that we saw previously on the earlier slide. So we're going to leave those the way they are. If we needed to change them for some reason because they didn't work, then we could just copy and paste, copy and type the word set, and then paste, and change that from on to off as an example, and a little toggle bar comes on. And then we could hit return, and type save, and then go back to our CLI and type get serial again to verify that it actually did save. And here you see it's off. Well, we want to change it back to on what it was. So I'm going to do it again. Set, paste, change that from off to on, enter, save. And now our jumper R1F receiver is set up properly in Betaflight. Let's go ahead and see if our channels are working with our control signal. Now let's go to our receiver tab and make sure our control signals are working properly on our channels. Throttle, excellent. Yaw, outstanding. Pitch, and roll. Good stuff. Now let's go see how our telemetry is working.
All right, now that we've got our jumper R1F receiver set up properly in Betaflight, let's go ahead and see if we can get some Fport telemetry on it. First of all, we're going to go to our telemetry page and our model setup and delete all sensors. And yes, really, we're going to delete them, which I've done. And then we're going to go down here to discover new sensors. Whoa, look at that. Look what populated. These are all the telemetry values that we're getting with our jumper R1F receiver. The ones I'm specifically looking for are VFAS, which is my battery voltage, and RSSI. With RSSI and VFAS, I can use those values to initiate audible alarms in my transmitter rather than having to look at my OSD during flight. So now we've got our jumper R1F receiver with Fport telemetry working properly with our jumper T16. And that's a good thing. So that's the inexpensive yet fully capable jumper R1F receiver. Remember, you have the complete free setup checklist available for you in the video description below, as well as links to the jumper R1 receiver itself. Let me know in the comments below if you'll be using the jumper R1F receiver yourself or what your favorite receiver is that you do use. Hit that like button and subscribe for new videos every week. Thanks for watching, and make sure to check out the TMac FPV site and this video next to start and continue your journey to better FPV fun. I'll see you next time. Clear skies, friend.